Hello everyone. I'd like to tell you today about the new method we've developed for integrating high-throughput data with genome and metabolic network models. Why this computational method called constraint-based modelism on a genome scale? Microorganisms, it has their locations. Now, some visualize biochemical reactions. To describe the levels to measure metabolite concentrations. Metabolic flux, deduction or elimination. Of a metabolite, most informative feature in the network state of the cell. The same framework of constraint-based modeling, however, constraint-based different constraints, and the challenge. Is how to identify before we delve into the specific methods described the problem we're facing. So the body clock the whole world and today we're facing an ever data proteomics metabolomics flux is very limited to only a fraction of reactions we had information on a large set of reactions in the net sample better understand the mechanisms of different diseases. We could more accurately design specific strains for, and there are many applications that the performance could improve significantly. So of the important evaluated axes and learning them experimentally. Our goal here and will use them and integrated genome scale symbolic models in order to model reality in the best possible way. Now the task of integrating experimental data with genome scale models can be different ways and also the best by others. Yaka started 2004 and Baker and Paul's gene expression to identify genes that are absent context and then minimize the flux through the so slow it is high cues to the reaction. Although integration of metabolomics in 2006 by when they do genetic or environmental perturbations through surrounding metabolites. Metabolomics that was in 2007 in directionality based on the dynamic principle in this work. Or proteomics and metabolomics. And these methods that I've just described actually send fluxes to each one of the reactions in the network, but more aims to say some of activity. The integration is done in a quantitative manner by considering a heuristic model reaction rate such that eventually we produce a complete and sustainable flux distribution. So back now, the two more widely used computational methods in this modeling that all to define a complete and feasible flux distribution in different sets of different active functions. The first method is called flux balance analysis or FBA, and it searches such a solution that given a growth nutrient medium, most might its function, which is the growth rate of the organism. in a steady state, which means that metabolite conversions are constant in time, and therefore their production rate is equal to their consumption rate. This is called the mass balance constraint, and you can see here, for example, that metabolite B maintains this property with the flux produced and consuming it respectively. Another constraint is the thermodynamic constraint, and it reflects our knowledge on reaction. And you can see that reaction V5 can be one direction. Together, this set of constraints allows a linear probe that searches for feasible to maximize its objection and the biomass production. Another widely method is called MoMA, for minimization of metabolic, and it was developed for searching for such a flux distribution and genetic perturbation. It's basic assumption metabolic flux under minimal redistribution in respect to, and it therefore look for which is as possible of the wild type. And here, for example, you can see that out there are a few solutions with this reaction metabolic flux, but is the one with the other type. Now you can see that this last year network topology and based trends and don't take into account IOMA for metabolics analysis uses the available high throughput data in order to integrate it with the model and searches for feasible solution in this space to further constrain this solution space in order to find solutions that will model reality in the best possible way. The integration is done in a quantitative manner by considering a mechanistic model of Michaelis-Menten-like reaction rate. Now you can see this question can be evaluated by the information on gene expression or proteomics, metabolomics, and genetic parameters, where the Vs are the fluxes, of course. In theory, all that information we can directly compute through this equation. However, no problems. The first problem is that metabolomics is available for only a subset of problems. So the first problem by the subset of core M, for which experimental data is available for, we have the information on G-expert concentrations, and we can then evaluate core and look for a solution which is as well as and what do we mean by that? That assuming we have all necessary information in the reaction here called bound, we can, in order to compute the flux, and let's say that we are the now we can easily search for solution constraints in the work, and we'll look for flux specifics assigned to this reaction is obtained by the rate equation. A possible solution, this reaction got 9, which is in this case. Now we recall this reaction in problem analytic parameters. But you can see this equation is linear, so we could easily add variables to our formulation. And that's true. Together in this formulation. Moreover, we actually are doing so. Note that when we look on different knockouts, expression and metabolomics, it's different. However, the key for each enzyme separately all of the different cups. So when we net a constraint, we actually assign between across the these conditions, and this allows us to make conditions together at the same time. Situation that may verify this point. As usual, we have the basic mass balance and directionality, and we find feasible solution to each condition separately. However, now that we add the enzyme kinetic constraints and parameters for each of the core enzymes are constant across the different conditions, associate between each one course across the different conditions to find a feasible solution to make conditions together, which time was not aided by any other methods. That we established in general. Let's see how it works. Our first model is the dynamic kinetic model of the general cells. Using this model, we can do each one of the reactions in the network, as all kinetic parameter laws are all known. And this, of course, allows us to do the direct evaluation to IOMA, as all it's necessary input in this case. So we indeed each one of the reactions in rock, obtain the distribution for each and the wild type. And then we simply wanted to evaluate in predicting the change between the wild type and each one. We did in two scenarios. Only the basic requirement is given as input. Forms of ion in dark blue are better than that by more. In our second scenario, we now that to each one of the methods, but the uptake and attrition rate and are much easier to measure. And see, while MoMA's performance improves its test, the performance of MoMA is still better. Note that FBA cannot be applied here, as it relies on an object in a kinetic model. And second, we had to make some effort in this case, since it relies on wild type flux distribution. So in this scenario, we sampled the wild type and we used the general information on exchange reactions that are not needed in order to apply the method IOMA in this case. And this is quite a small model. And our improvement is quite modest. So we went on a scale model. And the second recommendation was on a polygenic model, accounting for more than 1,000. We used the data of Tomita et al., where they measured both and fluxes of validation under 24 genetic perturbations in E. coli. Central and working from the meta database, and we again wanted to form of the method putting the changes in the wild type in one of the dock conditions. So for IOMA, much better than that achieves of precision recall accuracy. What is the end value of one of the data we metabolomics data alone. That again, while in most cases the performance of the other methods, the advantage of using both certainly done in IOMA is better and achieves much better. Lastly, I want to show you a small examples of the predictions made by the different methods. So you can see here a subnetwork of E. coli with glycolysis and the pentose phosphate pathway, and of the T marked here, catalyzing this reaction here, marked in the line. And colored in green are the ones that the flux has been elevated for, and the white colored in red are the ones that the flux have been reduced. And you can see while FBA correctly predicts this method through the glycolysis, it does predict it in the pentose-phosphate pathway. MoMA, in this case, fails to predict the changes in the right direction actions. And finally, IOMA correctly predicts this measured pattern through glycolysis and through the pentose-phosphate pathway, except matches over there. So I would like to summarize that IOMA is an approach for integrating different genome-scale metabolic models. Integration is done in a quantitative mechanistic model for pathway. It's specific for allows to apply it with partial experimental data. That, since the way we formulate our we can find physical solutions conditions together. It was also shown to successfully predict both the human blood cells and in E. coli central metabolism. However, the core enzymes that were used for which experimental was available for was relatively small. However, we can easily use this core in order to how the performance of the method will change. And we did the size of the core enzyme increased by the method. So we probably won't be wrong to assume that the performance of the food would improve even further. There is no doubt that additional validations on genome scale models is required. The problem is that it's very difficult to find data sets having metabolomics and flux of validation. That all is the most recent. Possible to consider other rates than Michaelis maintain. Simulate them in a linear way that can be solved efficiently. Something that can be done is to consider other constraints that are not taken into account and could be used to further and prove that prediction. Next, Benigni Wolf from Liebermeister. My advisors are working at Atomic the SAB Department of Energy and National Science Foundation that made it possible for me to come here and present my work. And thank you for your attention.
For the next talk, and have time for a couple of questions.
Thank you. It's a nice talk. I was wondering, in your value, basically viewing downs and changes,
yes,
rather than looking at any magnitude or quantity, as opposed to, it's very unclear if you're very intermediate ones or are important ones, and
thank
what
you
are sort of ways to measure
that's
aspects.
A great question. And we found that in this term, is very much alike. However, on predictions between different conditions, we saw if our method is better. It's a great question. Thank you.
Another question. They have done sensitivity analysis, or think of what the analysis for the kinetic parameters, because a biochemist would look at this and say you're in the kinetic parameter fixed fractions.
Yeah.
Most biochemists would say that's true, and they have a lot of experimental, particularly because a lot are derived from depending on what enzyme you're looking at, sensitive are your prediction to those.
It's a great question. We actually did not done the thank
you for your talk.
Thanks.
I'm just wondering about data that you have on the E. coli. Okay, how many proteins are you covering, and how good
I think there were about 70 or 80 measurements of proteomics and much less metabolite concentration, something like that.
Actually, the major reach the flux is to reduce the complexity, but you bring the parameter and then high throughput data. Looks like homogeneity rather than the reducing down the scope. This verification. And the second one is a feeling point of view. How can we use your strain implement, like improving the productivity?
Can you please
like
repeat the question?
Second question? First question, complexity issue. So, can you need know the your can part of, for example, know that this is in vitro data. So, we are not the library model now.
We are set
your
we can use KM data.
Yeah. So actually. The reflux balance analysis, you don't need any parameter. Right. In case, we need any parameter.
Yeah, right. We have. Yeah, you're right. We need KM, but this is that we actually. This method in general relies on is available. And this is why we thought that integrating scale will improve the predictions. But in any case, this method does not know, there is no way to this method.
How can you use your method to improve an example? Can you use your method to improve your for example, we like genetic cell to produce the product. Can you use your method?
I'm not sure, but we can
talk about
it later.
Okay,
thanks.
I just had a quick question. So, reconstruction have like allosteric edges. Okay, sorry. A lot of reconstructions of metabolism, allosteric edges, sort of like also reconstructed. So, how easy? Because I know you have this sort of like, you know, constraint the equations that you're using. So can you start in like inhibitory, you know, sort of like allosteric inhibition?
Or simply just a model, and we haven't done any regulation of any case and
sure.
Yet.
Yeah.
So I have a question. If flagellant acid is or MoMA. May have more than optimal solutions.
Right.
Regular magnetic model. So, in your model, do you see a problem here?
And as long as we are looking for, indeed, flux solution, but there's another method that I've not done to VA, where you can measure the minimum. And massive flux reaction, and we indeed saw that set of fluxes we had reactions, there was no reaction in this slide. In any case, if we apply or any other constraint-based modeling method, you can maximum and see if you have a space of solutions or
okay, good.
Thank you.
Questions?
Okay, so speaker again.